sins and griefs to bear.
Frustrated by it, I would tend to be more along the lines of frustrated by it. Why would I say I'm frustrated by it? Would you dare to guess? What's it about? Working on the Sabbath. So why would I have a problem with that, being a preacher? That's what I tell people all the time. Man, they got me working every Sunday. But, no, apart from that, here's the issue that I have with it. There's nothing cut and dry. For instance, if I went around the room and I started asking you individually, are there some things that you don't do on Sunday? Are there some things that you don't feel like that we should do on Sunday? Every person here would probably have something. But again, the lesson is forcing us to look at kind of these preconceived ideas of what we have about the Sabbath. And let me say, when I talk about preconceived, in the Old Testament, there were some harsh punishments for doing stuff on the Sabbath. Such as the man, when the children of Israel were out in the wilderness, they were told that they were not to even light a fire, start a fire, or gather firewood. And they caught him on a Sunday out gathering firewood. And what was his punishment? Stoned him to death. I don't know why the man was doing it. I don't know if it was cold or if he needed to cook something. But there was that illustration that, you know, you were required to observe this day of rest, complete rest. So for me, the lesson just kind of leaves it ambiguous. It's not cut and dry. You can do this and you can do that. You can, you know, and as I said, we could go around this room. For instance, maybe you still don't do this, but I think that, Mrs. W., you said that you had relatives that they would not cook on Sunday.
They did nothing on Sunday.
They prepared all of their meals on Saturday, and Sunday you didn't dare go in the kitchen to do any sort of cooking.
Used to be didn't have a store on Sunday.
Used to didn't have a store.
No, not at all.
Well, even when I was
home,
we did not mow. Washing, we did none of that. No, we honored Sunday. It was the day to work.
Well, you remember God told the people to collect enough manna for 2 days. If they did and they collected too much, it would go bad.
That's right. But there wasn't going to be any out there if they went to look on it on Sunday. And so that's really the issue that I have with the lesson day. Here's where, you know, my concern is too, because I know some people are going to take this lesson and they're going to say, well, we just need to understand from this lesson, we have complete freedom to do whatever we want to do on Sunday. Now, when I say that, do we? Do we have complete?
Absolutely not.
Okay.
That strikes me. That blood that Jesus shed to bring us back into God's kingdom demands such a higher price out of our conduct, our behavior, and we don't recognize it. It's like we're going to keep coming back. I'm being real honest with you. I've given up hope on people. Now, I'm just sitting here saying, Jesus,
don't say it.
Jesus,
you've given up hope on them? Oh, Becky, no, surely not.
If you even knew the people, okay, I told you that when I ran into the store the other day, I finally got smart enough to call the girl that mows my grass, and she's got to come in. How many neighbors who have come to me because they needed some money for medicine or something? You know, I mean, over the last couple of years, not one of them. Driving by my place, one of them even came up and stood on my porch and knocked on my door and said, his brother had a real problem with constipation that I had, and I could give him. This was just in amongst all the snow. Not a one of them touched my sidewalk or anything. I finally did have a guy from one of those stations. He stopped and he said, "Becky, what's your problem?" Okay. And he got out. I had dropped some of the shovel, and he shoveled the rest of it, and he put ice melt. I had ice melt, but he put it down for me. But this is a stranger who kind of like knew me a little bit, but not much, because he's come to me with Bible questions before. But people I know, people I have done things for, they're just, Ina, I'm sorry. And you asked that question a couple of weeks ago. What happens? Because they're just helpless.
But I go back to the initial question that I asked that you responded to, was that, is the lesson trying to teach us that we have complete freedom because Christ is in charge of everything? I try to insinuate that I think that some people are going to teach the lesson today and say that's what they get out of the lesson. You know, that you do have complete freedom because of your faith in Christ. That, you know, there aren't really any boundaries or guidelines, that you can do whatever you want to. And again, the question that I have is that, do we want to get to a place in our lives that we don't have respect for a day off? And I oftentimes refer to it as the Lord's Day. I don't refer to it as a Sabbath. The word Sabbath literally means kind of a day of rest. But the Sabbath in the old Jewish law was on what day?
Saturday.
And we call this the Lord's Day because it's the first day of the week. That's when they went to the tomb and they found it empty. So we celebrate. It's celebrating the fact that Jesus lives. That's why we come together. But my concern is that we've become so irreverent within our society that we have no respect at all, not only for a day of rest, we don't have respect for the Lord's name, we don't have respect for law enforcement, we have lost total and complete respect for everybody and everything. And so I'm gonna do the best I can to walk us through this lesson. The frustrating thing is that when we leave this class, I don't know that we'll have every question answered. Like, what can I do? You know,
Here's the way I do my boundaries. Like somebody is really hurt and they need help right then, I'll do whatever needs to be done and I'm trying to help them. And I don't think that's a sin. I think that is, you have to just know personally where you're at with it. So I have my own guidelines. I'm not gonna go out here and just be working it or doing whatever.
And you hit upon a key thing that I think that we'll bear in mind as we go through this lesson, because I don't know that we're going to come with complete group consensus on everything about what's acceptable. Each person is going to have to operate from their own comfort level. It's kind of like with this whole COVID shutdown. I don't mean to leave you out of here.
April, I'll
turn my head from time to time. But some people are comfortable coming to church, and then there's other people that aren't. And I try to make a point all the time to say, look, if you're not comfortable, that's fine. You know, all that you're going to do is sit here in church and worry about whether or not you're coming down with it. You're not going to be comfortable. Everybody's going to pick up on that. So I'm just trying to say with the lesson, you're not going to be able to walk out of here and say, well, everybody's going to support me in my comfort level. Because I'll use my illustration myself. Janet's already told you what her attitude is. Yep, help people. Yeah, I'm in favor of that. But then I raise the question, what if there's another day of the week that it could be done?
That's what I'm saying. It depends on how serious it is.
It is.
Yeah, like mowing a yard or doing stuff like that. I don't personally see that. But I know there are people that work, and that's the only time they have. So I don't judge. I don't judge people doing that. Because I don't know, I'm not in their shoes, walking their footsteps. You know what I'm saying?
And that's right. And you're nailing it exactly, the problem that I see with the lesson today, because some people that leave here feel like, I got no problem if I want to go home and mow my grass on a Sunday. and then go ahead and get it done. And we don't know what else is going on within their lives. I don't know if they've got a really big, you starting to say something, Mary?
A lot of things is man's idea of what to do on Sunday.
It is.
And
it is,
Jesus,
but
Jesus healed even on Sunday.
It is, but again, I'd kick you back to the Old Testament reference with the guy that picked up sticks on a Sunday, gathered firewood, and he got stoned to death.
But was that wasn't Jesus, that was...
It was God's order. God had basically dictated, you're not supposed to be doing this. And they caught him and they brought him before the Lord and the priest and said, what should be done? Kill him.
That's what Israel's problem was. They wanted to be like the other countries around them. That's how they ended up with Saul, instead of, you know, Samuel told them all this stuff that's going to happen to you if you do that. Mankind wants to be like our neighbors, and he was still at that time trying to teach him stuff. I think we're beyond being taught anymore. But God was trying to still teach him, hey, this is what I told you, have faith in me. Your relationship is with me, I am your creator, I am the leader of Israel, and if you need that firewood, then you come to me. I can talk to the neighbor down the street, and Chuck, he's going to send Chuck down and say, hey, I got a couple of extra sticks of firewood. Can I give you this? You know, but we miss that making God a center of everything.
I like the first part of what you said. I'm not saying I didn't like the other, but I really keyed in on, you said that people wanted to be like the other nations. And that's one of the dangers that I see for the church today with this lesson, is that we can quickly abandon, and we have to a large degree, abandon our respect for the Lord's Day. We do, and I've seen it increasing within our lifetime, treat the Lord's Day as if it was every other day. And if we don't respect, you know, a day for the Lord, I don't think we can expect the world to.
When we went to King's Creek, there were probably 4, maybe 5 men that worked turns. They had to work Sunday. They were always there Sunday night or Wednesday. I mean, they didn't take that day to say, I don't have to go to church. They would come Sunday night or Wednesday night. Never missed.
Well, and there used to be that kind of commitment to a time for the Lord. And again, it's not required in the Bible that we got to come to Sunday school or Sunday morning worship or Sunday evening or Wednesday evening. But again, it's a way of showing our honor and our respect. And the lesson today, for me, there's not going to be any clear-cut guidelines when you leave this of what's acceptable and what's not. The thing that I just kind of throw out there is don't allow the Lord's Day to just become like every other day. Because I feel like that the Lord deserves better than that.
And our government, because while you were this morning, they called me Friday and said, you have to go have a COVID test. You have to have it Sunday morning because of this procedure coming up. Wednesday morning. But I just had one 2 weeks ago. So the government, whoever is in charge of these hospitals and demanding and making these rules, they just said, that staff over there, that staff had to work today. Okay, and I'm glad you're there for somebody who might really be sick, but the emergency rooms are always there. But, I mean, they are disrespecting our government. They disrespect,
You're all right, Becky.
Your lesson points that out, that even though they stopped and picked the grain, that was considered harvesting.
Right.
They did it because they had to do it. They were hungry. You know? So I think there's a leeway there somewhere.
If you have to.
Yeah.
It kind of goes back to what I said. I think a lot of times we could do things on another day, but we say, the Lord's Day is kind of fair game. And I'm going to go ahead and sacrifice the Lord's time. And I, as I look at what's going on within our nation, and I'm closing in on 60. I ain't there yet. April's not there. I am getting close. But I have watched during my lifetime a steady growing disrespect for the Lord. As Clyde used to say, they used to have putting stuff closed on Sundays. And we treat it every day as the same. So that was the real issue that happened with the lesson. Of course, we're going to deal with two areas with today's lesson. One is, when you're hungry, it's okay to do something, or when you're helping somebody. Raises a question, are there other times that you could end up, you know, doing stuff on Lord's Day? And again, as you begin to add on your list of things that you could do on Sunday, again, I just wave a cautionary flag. Don't allow Sunday to become like every other day. Because originally, I believe that, yes, it was set up as a day of rest, but I think that there's also the clear indication that we need to spend time with God. It's not just rest, it's also worship. And we've kind of lost that within our society. So.
Yeah, I'm thinking this. I got a message from, I think it was Pastor Evans. And she said, it was a picture of, I don't even remember what the picture was, but she said, aren't you so glad that Ross Perot ran, because otherwise Mitt Romney would have been our president. And my reply back to Pat is, God's always working. We might not know it, we might not recognize it. But see, when you do, but I'm saying that's, 25 years ago? We didn't do this. We started this in, well, basically with FDR, when they started putting in a lot of the legislation. Woodrow Wilson was another one who was a precursor. We didn't come to this state of affairs because they were not buying alcohol. The stores weren't open. The TVs did not exist back in those days. My grandpa had the first TV in Titus, around Titusville. And I was a little girl. I remember that. It's a big deal. It's because our hearts are cold. Our hearts are far, far, far away from him. And it's not the little nitpicking things like eating grain or picking up wood and stuff. It's like, are we worshiping him? Are we honoring him? And that's where we're failing, is we're not worshiping him. We don't value him for that sacrifice on the cross. That was such a hard crucifixion. I mean, I can't imagine anybody even watching it and not passing it. There I go. Right. I'm off on another tangent.
Well, again, you're trying to emphasize that we need a day to worship and reflect upon God and what he's done for us. And I agree with you. And we have lost that, a lot of that within our society. So we are going to go through the lesson. I just wanted to comment, and I don't know if you give much thought to it or if you just kind of blindly swallow everything that's put in front of you. But the lesson today does deal with the fact that as a Christian, you know, Jesus has basically come along and said, you know, you answer to me and me alone. And if you feel like that it's something that I would approve of, then go ahead and do it, because Jesus has that authority. However, as you deal with individuals, you may not get that same sort of support from somebody else. Somebody within the church may say, well, you may think that Jesus wants you to do that, but I wouldn't think that Jesus would want me to do that. So it's one of these lessons that there's not going to be any clear-cut guidelines, except that, you know, Jesus is the one in charge and you're going to have an account to him. But don't lose respect for the Sabbath, okay? Let's read the first passage of Scripture. Mary Collins, would you like to read the first passage, page 102? Thank you.
Work on the Sabbath. On the Sabbath, he passed through the grain field. His disciples were picking heads of grain, rubbing them in their hands, and eating them. But some of the Pharisees said, why are you doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath?
Okay, and I think that the lesson, at least in the teacher's book, it says picking the heads of grain and rubbing them together in one's hands to separate the edible kernels pointed out that this is probably wheat. So that has to do with harvesting. It has to do with threshing. It has to do with, you know, preparing food. You talk about getting nitpicky. Jesus was, you know, he wasn't nitpicky like that. And I guess that's what I want to comment about this first passage of Scripture. If you start getting nitpicky, you can get nitpicky about everything. It's what they should have done. But anyhow, I don't know what else to say about this passage of scripture, quite honestly. If you're hungry, get something to eat. I know that Jana talked about within her family that they wouldn't do any cooking on Sunday. Until I came to Calvary Baptist Church, what about me and eating on Sunday? Does anybody know? Did you hear what she said? Until I came here, when it came Sundays, I wouldn't eat out. And again, the reason people say, well, why'd you do that? Because I felt like, well, I don't want to keep people from out of church. And I finally came to the conclusion, I'm not keeping anybody out of church. They ain't going to go. But really, it was one of those things that when I moved up here, my brother, you know, oftentimes had to come to church because I stayed with him for, 6 months that I was here. I started in August, and I got moved into my house, I think, in February. So roughly 6 months. So he would come to church on Sunday. Of course, he'd have, because his wife was working, and so he'd have the two children. And it was kind of like, we can't go home and eat because he didn't want to disturb her. So, and I'm not placing the blame on him because after they grew up, I've just continued to eat. But I'm just saying it can become a real issue. I know that when I was in seminary, the kids, because I was a youth minister, on Sunday nights after church, they would, because we were in Taylorsville, 25 miles outside of Louisville, they would get in their cars and they would drive off to like a Pizza Hut or Hardee's or someplace like that to get something to eat. And I'd go along. I'd sit there with them and talk with them, but I wouldn't get anything to eat. So, you know, nobody ever got on my case about it. And I tried not to make them feel guilty about it. But again, that's what I said, is that some people still practice this. You know, I'm not going to eat out on Sunday. Is there a clear-cut answer on it? I don't want us to get, you know, in a free-for-all, because some people have very strong convictions about things. But Jesus was just trying to say, look, I don't want it to be nitpicky when it comes to food time on a Sunday. You need something to eat, get something to eat. Well, I guess the issue here was that what they did in order to get something to eat. You know, for instance, I don't know if you've got things that you won't do on Sunday, but I know that one of the things that I grew up, that we didn't do any fishing on Sunday. So let me throw this in the equation. I still don't go fishing on Sunday. But if I'm hungry and I need to catch a turtle to eat, I grab a pole.
Oh, even when I was a kid, I had to work on Sunday because they would all eat the most was like 35 at our house. Everybody come to my mom's house. My dad would kill 5 or 6 chickens the day before. My mother would clean.
I like your dad.
My mother would clean. She made homemade noodles and everything on Saturday. And then on Sunday, we always had all her relatives would come down from Pennsylvania. And there would be dozens of kids. I not exaggerating, that there, the one Sunday, there was 35 at our house to eat. Nobody brought anything. My mom fixed it all.
Okay.
The day before. And, but I had to do dishes after they all ate.
My dad felt that way.
Well, we had to do dishes a couple of times because there were so many people. They didn't have that. They didn't have paper plates.
There you go. So, there you have it.
Yeah,
for those who didn't
work. That wasn't right. See, we didn't work or anything, but when we had company on Sunday, I never pitched horseshoes, but that's what they done. So, I mean, they were pitching horseshoes, you know, or us kids were going to play badminton, so I don't know if that, you know.
See,
so there you are.
Again, I'm trying to introduce some of these conflicting ideas that we've had and carried around, because we still carry around with us. I mean, they're deeply rooted. They go back to our childhood. It was okay for us to do something activities-wise if it was free, but it was wrong to pay for it. For instance,
we clean up the cars. We wax the cars. You know, Daddy bring the car down. We wax the car, shine the car up. Well, that's kind of working.
Well, see, we wouldn't do that. We wouldn't do that on Sunday. And that's what I said, is that when you get finished with this lesson, you're still going to have all these questions about what's acceptable and what's not. Back to the, you know, like paying for recreation. We wouldn't pay to go to a swimming pool. But we could go down to the river and we could go swimming for free. You know, either way, you're going to be swimming.
I had never been in a regular swimming pool. So after I got grew up and married, I always went into creek.
Who was that?
My kids went into creek.
So, again, and we'll go to the next passage of scripture, because we're not dealing with the activity stuff right now. We're just dealing with the food issue. If you need something to eat, get something to eat. Jesus doesn't want you to go hungry. And if it means cooking, you know, if it means preparing the food, then Jesus doesn't want you to go hungry. As I said, these Pharisees, they got nitpicky about it. And I feel like Jesus is trying to say, don't get nitpicky about it, because you can get really nitpicky about everything. And don't do it. The main thing is to keep the main thing the main thing. The main thing is the person's hungry and they need to get something to eat. Again, as we go through the rest of this lesson, I'm going to keep coming back to this point that I want to make. The danger is that I feel like we'll have a tendency to just accept everything on Sabbath, and then the Sabbath won't, or the Lord's Day won't have any special significance. And I don't ever want us to become like that, because I'm afraid that some people are going to take this lesson today and say, well, Jesus says okay for me to do anything. Okay, well, you go ahead and do that, and then you're no different than the rest of the world. And I think, as Becky alluded to earlier, our Lord deserves more respect than that. And quite honestly, our society needs to be reminded that we need respect and reverence. We have become a very irreverent society. So, no final comments about the threshing of the grain? You want to go to the second passage?
I can do that, sure.
Thank you.
Lord of the Sabbath. Jesus answered him, haven't you read what David and Ezra were with him did when he was hungry, how he entered the house of God and took and ate of the presence, which is not lawful for any but a priest to be. He even gave some to those who were with him. Then he told them, the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath.
So Jesus goes back into Scripture and he tells this story. The story is that King Saul was trying to kill David. He was jealous of David. David was running for his life. He stops off at this priest, where this priest was, where the tabernacle was, and he went there and got some of the bread of presence. The bread of presence meant that every day, as a gift to God, we may look at it as kind of foolish, but they would prepare a fresh loaf of bread and take it in there and let it sit there basically all day. And then the only person that could eat that, it was, they called it in the Old Testament King James Version, the show bread. You'd end up like, why are you letting that fresh bread get stale? Well, it was seen as an offer to God. Then after it had spent basically the day getting stale, then the priest and their family could come and they could eat it. But they were the only ones that were allowed to eat that bread. Well, David was hungry. And so rather than just continue to go hungry, he goes in there and asks the priest, is it okay if I have some of that bread? No, you can't have any of that. Let me use this as an illustration. This thought popped in my head as I was thinking about the lesson. Suppose you're really hungry and you came here to the church, and the only thing that we had left was communion bread. Now granted, Sheila would end up, used to get the boxes. Now we've got these cups with the little cellophane wrapper that everybody had trouble with last week getting those things loose. Oh boy. Really tough on older folks. They can't get their fingers to work. It's cruel. It's cruel. They've probably got hidden cameras somewhere photographing the frustration the old generation has. It is work. It is work.
I didn't the first time. Well,
it used to be we would get a little box that had a bunch of the little. I don't mean any disrespect, but when I was in seminary, in Southern Seminary, Bill Leonard was my history professor. He called them Baptist chicklets. That's kind of what, I don't mean any disrespect by it. But, you know, you got that little box. But if it was the only thing to eat, would it be wrong to eat an entire box of communion bread if you were hungry? You're like, no, you don't do that, because that is, we assign a kind of a sacredness to those little wafers. By the way, the ones that come now on those cups, aren't they like styrofoam? They're terrible. I always wondered what happened to those foam peanuts. They reshape them into communion wafers. They taste terrible. But if you came to the church for that same thing, would you be upset with somebody that ate all the communion bread? It's like, no, you're not supposed to do that. Jesus is saying that's what David did in the Old Testament. And was God upset? But David was the teacher's pet.
You know, I think about that. Like, what would think about this lesson? We should prepare for our time. They should have been preparing for their Sabbath. They almost knew. Even they. They may have been out.
Well, David, of course, was running for his life. He was running for his life.
It would have been difficult for him. But
Jesus
today,
is.
And the man who went out to get the firewood, he knew that he was out of firewood before that day. He always prepared
for the Sabbath. Well, the sad thing was is that even if you had the wood, you weren't supposed to light a fire, if I understood.
Well, they always kept them burning anyway.
So,
then you go.
You would, Chuck. You would. You would. Well, again, Jesus is just trying to use an illustration from Scripture to say, look, folks. You know, don't make life so complicated. And here's where my difficulty again is. That guy that was collecting the firewood, he wasn't trying to make life difficult. But there were serious repercussions. And that's not the only place in the Old Testament where it says, listen, you folks are supposed to be respecting this day. You're not supposed to be doing anything. You're not supposed to be selling. You're not supposed to be trading. I know that the other day I saw something on OfferUp that I wanted to get. The lady lives over in Washington, PA, and I ended up sending her, she agreed to sell it to me. And I said, are you available today? She said, no, I'm out of town, but I'll be back this weekend. And I said, well, I can get together with you on the weekend, but preferably not on Sunday. Because, and it's not just because it's the Lord's Day, but it's also, Sunday's not a good time for me to have to make a trip over to Washington with services in the morning and services in the evening. But again, it just kind of raises the question, do we have things within our lives sometimes that, you know, we could end up really answering the question if we go back in Scripture. Because that's what Jesus did with regard to this issue. He just went back in Scripture and said, you know, it's right there in front of your eyes. You had King David, that he ended up getting some bread from a shower, which was not, that was not right. I mean, that's like eating communion bread. And yet, God didn't get angry with him because, and again, the Apostle Paul really tries to make this case in the New Testament. The letter of the law killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. When you become legalistic, it's something that is killing you. It's something that is robbing you of life. That's the letter of the law. The Spirit of the law, why God ended up giving us the laws, was to be of help to us. The Lord's Day was to teach us, I think, two things. Sabbath day, it was to teach us we do need to rest. And by and large, we as Americans have kept too busy. I think if there's a good thing to be said about this whole shutdown, it has slowed people down some. You know, that does present some other issues. I read the other day about the amount of alcoholism is way up. Drug use, suicide, so on and so forth. But, you know, the day of rest was originally set up to give us time to kind of recharge our batteries. Too many people are running on fumes, and it shows. But then the other thing was, I think, that it was to teach us respect for God and reverence for God. And I think our society is sadly losing that ability. But the Scripture is there to kind of give us some instruction and make us reflect upon the decision that you're wrestling with. Is it something that you can look in the Word of God, and there are some examples that can help you? Jesus is saying, look, it's not wrong to do it. And you've got an illustration here in the Bible that talks about it. King David, he was able to eat of that bread. And God wasn't upset with him because God understood King David needed to have his needs met. Not only King David, but the people that were with him. May I take just one moment to go back and give you some information about rabbinic writings. I know that within your book, page 102, down at the bottom in the orange box, it said the Mishnah, a written collection of Jewish oral tradition, includes a section entitled Shabbat or Sabbath. The Sabbath section alone has 24 chapters and enumerates 39 activities that were forbidden on the Sabbath. And they encourage you, if you could, to look that up. Well, I didn't look it up, but the teacher's book ended up saying this. It prohibited, this section of the Scripture, it prohibited sowing, plowing, reaping, threshing, winnowing, sifting, kneading, shearing, spinning, sowing, hunting, dressing a kill, starting a fire, writing, using a tool, and carrying a burden. A later list added 6 activities that related to each of the other 39 activities. Still another list prohibits, this is especially good for Mary and Betty, it prohibits climbing a tree, riding an animal, swimming, clapping hands, dancing, or becoming engaged on the Sabbath. I love that one.
You know, that's they had all those do nots. I read an article one time where they were only allowed to travel so far.
Half a mile.
And what they would do, they would travel that far and put an article of clothing or something that belonged to the other people, then they could go that much farther.
Okay.
There was always ways that they could get around a lot of these things that they weren't allowed to do.
Always a loophole.
Yeah.
Well, and one that I heard about was that, if you're married, there's no need in both of you to use up your half mile on the same section, so she rides you the first half mile and you ride her the second half mile.
Oh no. She don't want to carry me.
Having said that, it reminds me back when I was a kid in grade school, junior high school. We had a kind of a fun day, Olympic sort of thing, and the neighbor girl and I, Teresa Mickelson, she and I still stay in touch two or three times a year. It was a piggyback race. I think it was like 50 yards or something. She rode my back 50 yards, and then I rode her back 50 yards. We won gold medal. We won first place. But nothing ever came of a relationship. I think I must have rode her too hard.
No more questions.
I think back then in junior high school, I think I weighed all of 95 pounds. We were real heavyweights. We were both around the same weight. But anyway, I kind of brought back memories. All right, so God ended up saying, look, or Jesus says, don't make life difficult. You know, oftentimes in Scripture, you can find illustrations that can end up answering the questions that you have. Just know that God looks at the heart. Man looks at what's going on the outside. God looks at the heart. And remember that laws that were given, it's the spirit of the law. Why was the law given? You know, and you can use modern day application. Why do we have speed limits? Is it just to make us take longer getting where we need to go? It's to save lives. The spirit is to save lives. But, you know, at times you may have to go over the speed limit in order to save a life. And that's what Jesus is trying to say. Just remember that there are times that you can refer to out of the Bible, and I'm kind of using this as an illustration of the Apostle Paul. He says, look, remember the whole purpose of any sort of a law needs to be to give life, to help life, not to detract from life or to hurt life. Okay? We have maybe just quick minute to deal with the last passage of Scripture. Who would like to read the last passage out loud? Miss Betty, do you want to read it out loud? Page 105.
Mm-hmm. On another Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and was teaching. A man was there whose right hand was scribbled. The scribes and Pharisees were watching him closely to see if he could heal on the Sabbath, so that they could find a charge against him. But he knew their thoughts and told the man that was scribbled to him, get up. So he got up and stood there. And Jesus said to them, I ask you, is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath or to do evil? Save life or to destroy it. After looking around at them all, he told them, stretch out your hand. He did, and his hand was restored. They, however, were filled with rage and started discussing with one another what they might do with Jesus.
Okay. Could Jesus have done this on another day? You don't think he could have? He could have. Why do you think he did it on this day then? To teach us a lesson. Look, the Sabbath is about doing good. That's what the whole Sabbath was set up. It was for our benefit, not just with rest, but also we need to be reminded of God's presence in our lives. You know, we have become more and more ungodly. If you don't believe me, and I know this that I bring this up from time to time, look at the language that's used by people these days. Even, and I'll throw this out there, even that is used in front of me as a minister, and the people know that I'm a minister, there is absolutely no respect whatsoever. And so the whole purpose of the Sabbath day was not only to teach us rest, but it was also to teach us respect and reverence for God. But I believe that Jesus used this thing of the shriveled hand. He could have found this man on another day, but he decided not to. He wanted to emphasize to people, look, the Sabbath is about doing good. But, now let me throw this in there. Maybe I should just keep my mouth shut. Dare I say it? I think we need to look carefully at if we could do something on another day in order to protect that day of rest, that we should do it. And again, I know that how much is too much? Where do I need to draw the line? And that's the frustration of the blessing. Yeah. But I'm just saying that I think that, you know, we need to bear in mind that that day was given to us because we do need our time with God. And we do need our time of rest.
Maybe we have done something on Sunday, but like if we did, it always went wrong. I'm serious.
That's what I always say. Yes.
The thing that strikes me about this, they were filled with rest. Well, we all obviously know what happened yesterday with the impeachment. Rage in our country. But it totally astounds me. And I look back at this, and there's a couple of places in my commentary where I have written in that on the margin, Trump, exactly what they are doing against him. It's just like, where did this rage come? I mean, it obviously out of the heart, right? It's just
out of the heart. Well, again, Jesus did choose to heal this man with a shriveled hand, and he could have done it on a different day, but he did. It just kind of reminds us the whole purpose of the Sabbath is for doing good. Now, the book brings out that it was okay on the eighth day after baby boy is born to circumcise him. And it's okay for you women to have your baby. I can just see you when the birthing pains start. Nope, sorry, honey, you have to wait till the next day in order to have that baby. You gotta hold it in. I can just see how far that's gonna go. You know? Don't tie yourself in knots. Remember that the main reason that God gave us, you know, the Lord said, this is my belief, was not only for rest, but for also to take time to remember Him. And as I've said, I've seen within our society, as we more and more have allowed the world's ways to claim the Lord's day, we have become more and more irreverent. And while I don't want us to go back into the days of the Pharisees where we, you know, get nitpicky about everything, I just kind of offer it as a cautionary word. Let's always try to remember, we need our time with God, and we also need a time of rest. If we have to, you know, do something on the Lord's Day that requires, you know, it to be done to help people out. Good to have April here. She oftentimes has to work on Sundays. You know, working at the hospital. God doesn't condemn you for that.
I think if your conscience, if you feel that you're doing something wrong, then you shouldn't.
You're right. You're not having peace. At the same time, you may feel good about something.
I don't feel good about something any day of the week. I don't do it. I mean, if I'm going to feel guilty about something, I'm not going to do it.
Good.
Some people go.
I try not to. But if you're not saved, yeah, a lot of times when you're not saved, they haven't been taught or they haven't accepted the Lord, so don't bother them. But it does if you're a Christian. So if you feel what's wrong, don't do it.
Right. Yes. And as a Christian, we all of us are answerable to the Lord. But I'm just offering it again as a caution. You know, if you're struggling with issues, ask yourself the question, is it helping or is it hurting? And especially keep in mind that the whole thing with regard to the Sabbath was so that we did get rest, but I believe it's also so that we could honor God. You know, and I think that within our society, we really lost that honoring God. We almost treat Sunday just like every other day of the week. And I don't know that God is pleased with that at all, to be quite honest. So, no final comments or questions. Let's have a prayer. Father, I did my best to try to teach the lesson this morning. It's something that we've all read, you know, since we were kids, these illustrations of what we're allowed to do on Sunday. We grew up under different sorts of regulations and rules and what we're allowed to do and what we weren't allowed to do. And even as we leave the Sunday school class this morning, I doubt seriously we can come with complete consensus if a list of what's acceptable and what's not acceptable is put before us. So, Father, there's really just kind of some question marks, but again, we're trying to learn from your word that we need to keep in mind that the Sabbath was meant for doing good, and it's supposed to be good for us, and it's supposed to be good for you. And, Father, we just pray that you will help us always to seek your guidance and to remember that we're accountable to you. We pray, Father, that you will help us to take time to honor you. Pray that we will take time to rest. And pray, Father, that through our actions, people will see that we really do love and respect you. So bless this lesson in our lives. Give us guidance. Help us always to honor you. Forgive us when we fail you. Bless now the service to follow. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.